Retreat. What is retreat? Hello? What is retreat? Retreat simply means drawing back. Draw back. Or move away from something. To draw back from something. Move away from something. Take some steps away from something. You retreat. Go back. Go back. Draw back. Move away. That's the meaning of retreat. And as I've always told those who come for prayer, who come for retreats in the past in this compound, I say, when we talk about retreat, it is actually a military, usually used as a military terminology. When soldiers go to battle, and they've been fighting with their opponents, their enemies. After a point, the commander-in-chief of the armed forces will call them, retreat. Once the commander says, retreat, all the soldiers will put down their guns and leave wherever the battlefront is and draw back. Back to a particular point, either back to the barrack or back to somewhere they have agreed that all of them will converge when they hear the command. The important thing is that they leave the battlefield and converge somewhere, go back. Why did they go back? Is it because the battle is over? Yes. So, as I was saying, retreat simply means what? Go back, withdraw, go away, or what? Take a few steps back from where you are. And I said, it is a military terminology. Use when soldiers are in the battlefield to call them back away from the battlefront where they have been fighting. To converge back either at the army barrack or at some meeting place that they had agreed, even before going out for battle, that when they hear the cry from the commander-in-chief of the army, retreat! Everybody! They all know to put down their gun, stop fighting, move away from the battlefront. And as I said, I asked you, I said, why are they doing that? Why are they stopping the battle, the shooting, the machine guns, and the bombing? Why did they stop dramatically and withdraw from the battlefield? Is it because the battle is over? Is it because they have already won their enemies? Is it because they have despaired and have given up hope? Is it because their enemies have conquered them? None of the above. It is a deliberate decision. It's a deliberate decision. They withdraw in order to go back and review how well they have been fighting the battle, to check themselves and what they have done so far since they went to war against the winning or losing. Remember that in the battlefield, everybody is just concerned about two things. Take care, take precaution, protect yourself, and conquer the enemy. That's all. Be careful not to be killed, but make sure you kill the opponent. Hey, they are shooting, moving towards the surging towards the enemy, making sure they are sending their enemies back, you know, and that the enemy is receding from them, or they are defeating them, or shooting them, or they are conquering the battalion of the other enemy, of their opponents. And remember that the soldiers are scattered in different directions in the battlefield. Some of you imagine, especially for those of you who are always talking about war, war, war. Let us fight. This country needs war. There's going to be no war in this country. For those who say, I think they imagine that this is that war is a case of push me, I push you, you fall, you get up. No. War is not push me, I push you. Or what I say, mbamba, wrestle. Come, let's wrestle together and see who will win. If you fall, you get up. No! War means more than wrestling. War is more than wrestling with just one opponent. War is war. Incidentally, I have witnessed war. The civil war in this country, I was alive. And we were where the war was taking place. So I can say that I have witnessed war. I heard all the machine guns. I heard all the bombing. I heard all the shooting. We lost relatives. My grandfather, he died from bullets. My uncle, an architect, he was shot dead by the opponent. And the other uncle too, Uncle Ebere, I lost relations. So I know what war is. I heard the guns with my 2 ears. I heard the machine guns. And when the machine guns are coming, it is just coming from like from the horizon. It's just like boom. Unendingly. And as the machine guns are going, the bullets are going in the air, hitting anybody at all. Just shooting the machine gun and not waiting to know whether it is killing a rat or a cockroach or a human being or a boy, a girl, or a child. The machine guns are coming from the forest around the town. Just release it. We gave it up. Hundreds of people are already on the ground dead. And it goes on that they can go on consecutively for 2 hours. By the end of the 2 hours, dead bodies are on the ground. People are running, shelter for their lives, and the bullets that are flying in the air from the machine guns can hit anybody, and they are gone. It could be your uncle or your father or your mother, it could be you. You are running, you don't know where you're running to. It's only when they surround the city or the town with their machine guns. So it's coming from all directions, you're in the middle. People that have not seen war are talking about war, and I keep saying, by the grace of God, there shall never be another war in this country. In Jesus' name. By the power of the Almighty God, there shall never be another one. Those of us who lost our relatives know what war is. Dear precious uncles that we were so fond of, my uncle had just come back from US as an architect. And the war just descended the same year he came back. That's how he died. What are you talking about? What am I trying to say? It is that kind of war that I'm talking about. That Christian soldiers are fighting spiritually against the enemy. We are surrounded by enemies on all sides who are throwing their machine guns and their bombs. And remember that during the war, if I remember clearly because everything is fresh in my mind as if it happened yesterday. It was traumatic, so I can never forget. As the machine guns are boom in the air, just throwing bullets from everywhere. That is how helicopters are flying in the air, dropping bombs. All you know is you don't see helicopter going, oh, everybody starts running. You don't know where you're running to. Where you're running to, you don't even know where the helicopter is going to drop the bomb. You may be running in one direction, thinking you're running onto safety, and the next thing the bomb drops in the very bush where you are. on the building where you are. And it just shatters everything. So with that kind of a situation, especially when it is war between two parties, as those ones are shooting their machine guns, maybe from that side, the other party are shooting from the opposite here direction, because they too, they want to defeat those enemies who are sending bullets with their machine gun. So these other ones are trying to retaliate. So the bullets are coming this way, they are coming that way, and as they say, you have two elephants suffer, you have two elephants fight, the grass suffers. It is the innocent civilians in between that get it hot. And all the houses are devastated and destroyed in the process of that. So, what I'm saying in essence is that in the war field, the soldiers are all on that side, but they are not concentrated together in one place, which is what some of you think, that war is a matter of 20 of us, let's go together and fight. And those ones are 20. We're talking about battalion. You know the meaning of a battalion? What does battalion mean? You don't know what one battalion means? Well, during the war, we were told that one battalion means 1,000 soldiers. Hello? That's what I was told. I don't know if that is correct. One battalion should be about 1,000. So sometimes, one battalion, two battalions are in the battlefield, up to 2,000. You think all of them are standing together in one place? They are spread out in the forest of their opponents, doing the same thing, determined to kill the enemy and to finish them and take over their territory. And then the enemy too, they also come in battalion, determined to push back the other ones and conquer them and make them recede to go back. So that is how the war goes. And as the machine guns are releasing and the bombs are flying overhead, nobody knows how many soldiers on this side or that side are dead. But every machine gun that goes releases bullets, and so many people are dead, and nobody knows. So the battle rages like that, day in, day out, day in, day out. 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 1 year. Civil war in Nigeria lasted how many years? 3 years. So it comes to a point during those 3 years, for instance, when they need to stop. And the chief of the army will give a command, retreat. And when he says retreat, all the soldiers that are still alive will stop the shooting, stop trying to kill their enemies. They just stop shooting for a while and stop. And they draw, they go back. They go back to a point in order to do what? So check. They will not do head count. It is when they retreat that they will know how many soldiers have died and how many are remaining. If they came out as one battalion of about 1,000 soldiers, it is when they retreat that they will be able to say, oh, roll call. They now do a roll call because they know who they sent out. As they are doing roll call, Mr. Yesufu, no answer. Is this sergeant or corporal, whatever they may be? Corporal this, no answer. Corporal this, Jacob, present. Corporal this, present. Sergeant this, no answer. Sergeant this, no answer. Major this, no answer. Colonel this, no answer. Sergeant Major this, present. 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 The other one, no answer. No answer. No answer. What does that mean? They are gone. Sumutu Kena. They don't die. Sumutu. They died. That is how those of them who are alive will know that. Oh. So this is all that is remaining. entered as 1,000. By the time they finished roll call, they found that there are only 200 people there. Only 200 soldiers remaining. That means 800 have been killed. If they didn't stop, if they did not stop and retreat, will they know how many have died? Will they know how many remaining? They may even think they are doing well. They may think they are trying. Not knowing that they have lost up to 800 soldiers. And don't forget that with the loss of 800 soldiers, for instance, that is how all their words, the weapons that those 800 soldiers carry, have also been lost. If those 800 soldiers had guns, with their death now, their guns are also gone. So it means that that battalion are left with only 200 soldiers and 200 guns. Whereas they started with 1,000 soldiers and 1,000 guns. Are they winning? Are they winning? If they did not stop, will they know that they are not winning? If they did not retreat, will they know that they are not winning? You now understand the meaning of retreat. And why the Christian must make a retreat. Not only the Christian, every right thinking person should retreat once in a while in their lifetime. And the more regularly you make a retreat, the more you check your resources and your strength and know whether you are winning or not. So when they discover that they have not been winning and that they have lost, still using the Civil War as an example, when they now discover that they are not, that they are losing, they are not winning, and that they have lost about 800 soldiers and 800 guns and weapons or ammunition, and maybe some of their armored vehicles have been set on fire by their enemies who conquered some of the soldiers on that side. All those on this side thought they were doing well because, you know, like I said, they are positioned in different places. So maybe the ones on this side are defeated, and those on the east, on this other side, did not know. They were fighting on thinking they were doing well. It's when they gather together, they find that, oh, why we thought we were gaining here? Yeah. Maybe some of our colleagues scattered on this side and on that side are already dead. So that means even their armored vehicles, the enemies may have taken them over or burnt them, and so many things lost. So what did they do? Without realization, they decide to do what? They will have to make up their mind. Do they want to continue this battle or not? If we want to continue, what must we do? Maybe we need to send signal to the headquarters. To do what? Yes, to send more soldiers. Maybe we have to ask them to give us 800 more soldiers. Or since maybe we went out with a battalion of 1,000. How did we lose? Is it that we did not strategize well? What were the factors that were militating against us? Is it that we did not plan properly? Or our weapons were not sufficiently sophisticated? Could it be that the opponents, the enemies, had better weapons than us? Could it be that they had more soldiers than we had? And came against us, maybe we came as one battalion, and they came out as five battalions. Is that why they were able to finish our people so quickly? Or is it that they were getting extra support from behind, which we were not getting? Could it be that our own soldiers were not sufficiently trained for this type of battle? Could it be that the method we used was outdated method, uncivilized, and maybe there is a more modern method of fighting that led our enemies to just defeat everybody, take over all our weapons, or some people were killed in the bush and their guns are lying there inside the forest? etc., etc. Could it be that our men were hungry, not enough food supply, not enough water supply? Could it be that our armored vehicles were not sufficiently protected? You know, many things. Could it be even that our commander, the person leading the battle, because you know, they have to have people that lead, could it be that our leaders were not sufficiently trained in the necessary military tactics? Etc. They have to sit and work it out. What caused this mass defeat? That they came out with 1,000 soldiers, only 200 remaining. Why? And remember that they would never even have known that their colleagues have been destroyed or neutralized, as they call them. That's the language of the military. They use the word neutralized. They would never have known that their colleagues have, so many colleagues have been neutralized in the forest without, if they had not stopped. They would never have known without the retreat. And they would have continued to fight stupidly until the enemy just pounced on the remaining 200 and finished them. That is why, in the military, they fight a little when they go to war. And at some point, they retreat. They make a retreat to check the success of the battle, whether they are winning or failing, and the cause of the failure. And if they are winning, they congratulate themselves, pat themselves on the back, and say, that means our strategies were good, our tactics were good, we are going to continue with our tactics. Or maybe they want to add even another new idea. And say, okay, since we have conquered our enemies on this side, because you see, I gave the example of those who were losing. But sometimes we are winning. So that's why I have to talk about the winning side. Sometimes we are winning. And if you have been winning, you want to accept and say, we've been winning, oh, this is good. By the time you come back, you do a roll call, you find that out of one battalion, only 100 are missing. And then you look back, and you ask those you positioned on that side, and those you positioned here, how far have you gone into this place you are supposed to conquer? They say, we passed the boundary, and we will conquer another boundary again, and went further. Oh, this one we say, are we too? We did this, we did that, in fact. We have taken over the palace from the whatever, etc. There is what I'm saying. Or we've taken over their barracks. So that means you're doing well. Okay now, what are the things that helped us? What method is that? This is what we did and that's how. Okay then, continue with it. And then they will have decide. Do you want to continue here? Since we conquered this place and that place. Okay now, we locate. We are going to move to this other side and conquer that other side.
Stop. Move away from the strength life. Move away from the hustle of life. My soldiers move away from the sound of machines, guns, bombs, bullets, and withdraw. You must stop. Move away from the busy. From the go. From the running around. That you all talk about. You need to stop. And do what I call a head count for yourself. In the military, they will count how many are remaining. You feel that you're making an individual retreat. You need to stop. The head count you need to do is to count day by day how many years you are now in the world and what have you achieved. You're not counting soldiers. You have to count yourself. Count your years. And say, I am now 70 years old. Or I am 50. Or I am 20. How far have I gone? How far have I come with God? How well have I done with my God? How much of my goals and objectives have I achieved in life? Because the soldiers in the battlefield, they have a goal, they have an objective, they have a mission. Their mission is to conquer this area, this. They set goals for themselves before going, which is why they are fighting. They don't just go fighting because they are annoyed with their enemy. They may be annoyed with their enemy, but because they are annoyed, they have a mission to do what? To conquer. And conquer them so far, this far, or if it's during the Civil War, to bring back Biafra to Nigeria. Bring back the Igbos to be one Nigeria. That was the idea. And the Igbos are fighting, they don't want to be part of Nigeria. So leave us alone. So in every battle, the two sides that are fighting have a goal, they have a mission, which they are trying to achieve. So from time to time, you the Christian, you must stop to see, am I achieving my goal, my objective as a Christian in life? But before you can say, am I achieving my goal, my objective? I want to ask you, do you even have any goal? Do you have any goal? Do you have any objective? Have you set down boundaries and territories that you want to conquer in life as a Christian? Have you set down and written down the achievements and what you want to achieve in this life as a Christian, as a child of God? Have you set down the mark of success as a Christian? What are the marks? What are they to call achievement mark, success mark in your life? So that when you want to retreat, you will have something to use as marking scheme. Let me call it marking scheme. As a teacher that I am. You have to have marking scheme with which you can mark yourself. Do you even have any instruments for your measurement and evaluation? Again, the teacher in me, okay. It's when you begin with a marking scheme, and then when you start checking, then you begin to, you have to have what we call what? Measurement. And something you were going to use to evaluate yourself. What is your marking scheme for yourself? What are the tools or the instruments for your personal measurements and evaluation in life, of your life? What were your goals when you started life? What were your objectives when you started life? What was your target when you set out in life? What was your vision? What was your mission statement? What was your mission statement? If you don't have a mission statement, how can you say, I'm achieving my mission? If you don't have a target, how can you say, I am winning, or I'm failing, or I'm making it, or I'm not made it? If you don't have a measuring yardstick, how can you know how far you've come? Somebody goes to the market to buy material. You don't have measuring tools. How do you know how many yards you are measuring? What is your measuring yardstick for your life? What are you going to use as tools of measurement? You have to have all those things. But by the time you go on retreat, your retreat will not be useful. Because you have something you're looking at. And you have the marking scheme. And you have the tools for measurement and evaluation. You have something with which you can evaluate yourself when you're on retreat. To be able to say, yes, I'm achieving desired goals and desired objectives. Yes, I am winning. Or no, I have failed. Or I am failing. I need to do something. And when you now know that you are failing while you are on retreat, that is not the time for you to begin to do what? To re-strategize. You begin to re-strategize. But before you can re-strategize, you first of all need to say, why did I fail? What are the things that made me to fail in achieving my goals, those goals I set, and my targets? That is, if at all you have a goal. But you must have a goal. You must have objectives. You must have a mission. You should have a target in life. Anybody who is living this life, no goals, no objectives, no target, no mission, what do I call you? What do I call you? And you will just pass through life like a goat and end up in somebody's pot of soup. And obviously, the enemy's pot of soup is where you are likely to end. So we will not live like animals, we must not live like the goat who just gets up in the morning and begins to move around. Mouth on the ground, just eating leaves and going from one place to the other. And if you notice what the goat does, as it is going, it is urinating anywhere. It is dropping its droppings anywhere. Just keep going, eating droppings here and there, urine here and there, smelling. Who has ever seen the goat having a bath? Have you ever seen the goat having a bath? Is it because the goat is not dirty? And the goat smells sometimes, you know that? Yes, especially the male goat, he smells. But he will not know that it is smelling to have a bath. That is why I say, when you don't have goals, objectives in life, I call you a wure goat. You're just moving, thinking only, just eating and living life. Drop your poo-poo anywhere, urinate anywhere, smelling, you go in, all your life smelling rubbish, thinking, never a bath, never cleaning yourself, never brushing your teeth, just keep going, wherever the night meets you, you sleep, until you land in somebody's pot of soup. And that is the devil's pot of soup. You become meat for the devil. That's what I mean. That should not be me. That should not be you. In Jesus' name. We are rational human beings. Created in God's image and likeness. Coming from the infinite wisdom and intelligence. Given some of that wisdom and that intelligence guide us through life and to make us like Him who made us in His image and likeness. Himself, who is a master planner, a master coordinator, absolutely intelligent, absolutely wise. From Him we came, in Him we live and move and have our being. To Him we must return, and that should be the goal. To become more and more like Him day by day until we rest everything in Him, safely and comfortably arriving home, back to our destination. So the further Christian or human being is on a journey. You have a mission, you have a target. You are homeward bound. You are on a journey. And your goal is to get there safely and comfortably. And to get there victoriously to wear the crown of the everlasting King who is waiting for you with an everlasting reward. Waiting to give you the crown of glory. To wear that crown of glory is your major task and ambition. Therefore, as you journey on, you stand against anything that will prevent you from getting there. That is where the battle comes from. You stand against every opposition to the crown. You stand against anything that militates against your getting to your destination, which is heaven. You fight against any opposing party that wants to hinder your journey to heaven. You stand against and fight bravely, violently, against anybody, anything, not just persons. You are fighting persons and things. And you are also fighting principalities and powers, rulers of the darkness of this world. You fight against all the spirits of wickedness in the high places that want to hinder you from getting your everlasting crown that is waiting for you. Because you are a Christian soldier, you are marching home from a mission on earth. You are sent to the world on a mission, and you want to get home safely, accomplish your mission, and get home safely. So that's your goal. Your goal is to arrive at heaven safely and comfortably and victoriously. Having accomplished your mission on earth, you have a mission on earth. So you have to know your mission on earth and also what your target is, what your goal is. My goal is to accomplish my mission on earth and arrive safely back in heaven. Praise the Lord. So you have to know your mission. So you are fighting two battles, actually. You have to fight against anything that will stop you from accomplishing your mission in the world. Then fight against everything and anything and any person that will prevent you from going safely back to heaven. There are two different things. Accomplishing your mission on earth and going back safely. And going back safely to heaven. And arriving at heaven to take a crown. You must take a crown. The Father is waiting with a crown for every victorious Christian. The crown of glory awaits every successful missioner on earth. Anybody that starts on a mission, he has a crown of glory waiting for you. So you want to accomplish the mission, and you want to go back to heaven to wear your crown of glory. So, you fight. Let's fight against your mission. Whatever fights against your mission, you fight it. Whatever fights against your returning back to the Father, you fight it. And I tell you, whether you like it or not, I tell you solemnly, you are surrounded by enemies of your mission. You are surrounded by people hindrance here and there, trying to make sure you don't get back to heaven. Agents of darkness are waging war against you. Here on earth, on planet earth, physically. And they are waging war against you spiritually. So in case you're wondering, who are the enemies I have to fight? The enemies you have to fight are agents of darkness. And they came out to prevent you from achieving your mission on earth and getting back to the Father to take your crown. These agents, as I said, some are in human form, some are in spirit form. We call them demons and the devil that your eyes cannot see. Some are in form of things, not even human beings. Some are things, in form of things. Some are in form of places. In form of places, in form of things. Some are in form of money. And the things trying to make you not achieve your mission on earth and get back to the Father to wear your crown. Some are in form of money. Some are in form of pleasures. You need to be very conscious of this fact. But it is not always that the obstacle to your mission that you have to fight comes in form of a human being. It can come in various forms. The point is that if you are a good soldier of Christ and a good child of God, you must be vigilant. You must be vigilant. You must be vigilant. You must be intelligent. You must be wise. You must be vigilant. You must be intelligent, you must be wise, and I mean it. Let me tell you, when they are selecting, when in the military powers of this world, that is to say soldiers, real earthly soldiers, when they are selecting soldiers to send to the battlefield in war times, I can assure you they don't send mumu to the battlefield. They do not send stupid people to the battlefield. They select people that, they select soldiers who are what? Intelligent, vigilant, and wise. They choose who to send in that battalion to fight their battle. So it is, you, Christian soldiers, on a journey to heaven, you have to be intelligent, you have to be wise. You must be vigilant. You do not allow yourself to become mumu. That is to be. You don't let yourself be timid, stupid, foolish, unwise, unintelligent, and half asleep while you're in the world. You cannot afford to slumber or sleep in this world. Even when you go to bed at night, there is need for vigilance while you sleep. Yes, you can ask me what that means. Even when you go to bed at night and you have to sleep, sleep in quotes, I say you have to be vigilant even in your sleep. And the enemy does not play on your sleep and play on your mind and interfere with your dreams. And then you wake up and say, they attacked me when I was sleeping. That means you were also spiritually asleep. It is one thing to sleep physically, another thing to sleep spiritually.
said the Christian must be broken spiritually and lost, mentally and lost, intellectually and lost. And even when your body is tired and you must take some rest, you sleep with your spiritual eyes awake. Praise the Lord. You must learn to sleep with your physical eyes closed, but with what? Your spiritual eyes alert and awake. You must give no sleep to your soul. You must give no slumber to your spirit. How? You pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. That's how to be spiritually awake. Pray without ceasing. To the extent that even while you are physically asleep, the spirit is praying. Because the spirit is used to be in a prayer mode all the time. Yes. Your spirit must be spiritually awake all the time. Because even when your eyes are physically closed in physical sleep, your spirit is spiritually awake in a prayer mode. I know what I'm talking about. Let's see now. What example shall I use for you? Some of you have these things they call telephones, your cell phones. You can put it in any mode you like. Am I correct? Plane mode. Am I correct? When you're in aeroplane, you do what? You put it in a aeroplane mode. So that you start to pick up the signals. Am I right? If you don't put it in aeroplane mode, those of you who have Android phones and smartphones, you know what I'm talking about. It will be picking signals. Be picking up signals and still dropping messages for you, dropping your emails for you, because it is picking signals from various networks. And so you hear the thing dropping, bagam, text message, email, this, that, alert, text alert, bank alert, MTN alert, NCDC alert. Okay, it should be popping. Because you didn't put it in a sleeping mode. When you now put it in aeroplane mode, you cut off signal. Even though you can still use it, but it will not get signal. You can use it for what? You can use it for recording. You can use it to listen to the music that you have recorded. You can use it if you have, the prayer, universalist. I can use my universalist even when it is in a plane aeroplane mode. For signal, it will never get. Because I have cut off signal. But when I want my phone to pick up signal, I will remove it from aeroplane mode. I will be able to use this for my universalist, for recording, for this, for that. But at the same time, I will get every signal. And alas, that is what I mean when I say that Christian soldier on a journey, on a mission on earth, and on a journey back to heaven, take us the goal of returning to wear the crown of glory in the kingdom of our God and Father, who sent your mission to accomplish it and come back and receive your reward. You cannot afford to put yourself with your spirit in a sleeping mode or in a aeroplane mode. Here you can no longer receive signals. You have to be alert. Even when you are physically sleeping, even when you are
your eyes are closed in sleep.
Never you send your spirit into what? Sleeping room.
Where you cannot longer receive signal.
Keep your spirit so alert with prayer and connectivity to God. Don't reach out connectivity to God, even while you are physically sleeping. Keep connected to God in spirit while you sleep. And with that connectivity on,
I'm using telephone language now. I finished using military language.
With that connectivity to God, your soul,
your spirit is an alert
of that telephone
that is switched on in active mode, not in a refrain or sleeping mode. You have to put your soul and spirit always in an active mode by staying connected to God, even while you sleep.
So while you are sleeping, you will be able to sense
the attack of the enemy.
And so,
receive signals of danger, even in your sleep.
And your spirit will rise
and fight back. Because it has been programmed to do so with constant prayer and practice and grace. Constant prayer, practice, and grace of the God that you are connected to. Your spirit will arise and fight once it hears a signal of danger, of battle.
And all of you know what I'm talking about.
Who does not know what I'm talking about?
You know what I'm talking about. There are times that you are asleep, physically asleep, and you know that you are being attacked.
Don't you sometimes?
And sometimes your spirit has been able to fight back. Am I correct? Even in your sleep, you are fast asleep, and you hear your face shout, "Chill,
God," when they come at you.
When they come and they want to, some of you tell me that they come to press you or they want to cut your body, so I hear something, and you are able to shout, "Chill, God," and you get battle in return, and you fight them back. And then you jump up, you wake up, and you say, "Oh God, thank you, thank you." You run away. You remember? Has it ever happened to you? If it has happened to you, raise your hand.
Yes.
So, even when your eyes are closed in sleep, it means that your spirit was not asleep. Your spirit was active enough to realize that there was danger from the enemy zone, and they were coming to attack, oppress you, or all those stories you tell. Sometimes you say, they were running after you, chasing you, and you were running, then you spoke and decided to fight back, and you conquer.
No! You were able to fight back because you are spiritually alert and connected to God.
And some people may say, "Oh, that's just a dream. Is that a nightmare?" But you know that some of these things are not just dreams. Because some of you have woken up and you have come here to show me the marks on your body. Some people have come to show me. I remember one sister came one day from the sister in the east. Come up and showed me. When she was saying that, I was looking at her. "Are you really sure you're here?" She said, "See, the mom is seeing my body. Marks, I see somebody use razor blade and put strong marks on her thighs and her leg. Another day she gave up the marks on her hand. Is that a dream? What is cutting her body? Some of our enemy forces, spirits of wickedness in the higher places, rulers of the darkness of this world, were attacking her. How they will attack her and carry the baby. They want to snap the baby she's carrying on her chest, her own, you know, her baby. And she will have to be fighting and pulling. And in the morning, the baby will have marks on the body, and she too will have marks. So some of us, these are not like just nightmares or hallucinations. No. The But if you are able to keep away spiritually, you would have known when they were coming. You repeated fighting before they got to you. Because when they tell those things, I say, where were you when they entered? Where were you? To the extent that they could put marks on your body, and you wake up in the morning and you see marks bleeding. Or fingernails that have scratched your body and all that. Where were you? Spiritually, when I say where were you, I don't mean that she shouldn't sleep. I mean, where were you spiritually? Where was your spirit? It means your spirit did not get a signal. Your spirit did not get a signal. Now, why did the spirit not get a signal? Because you have deadened your spirit. You have put your spirit in a sleeping mode. You have switched off spiritual signals by putting yourself in a aeroplane mode. You know what I mean? Remember, I'm using computer language. I don't mean that you're in an aeroplane, so let nobody get confused, please. Those who have the type of phone I'm talking about understand what I mean by putting your phone in a aeroplane mode. So that you switch off signals. So people, some Christians have switched off signals. They have switched off from God. They're no longer connected. So you become a prey to the devil. So it is important to maintain connectivity. Important to stay connected to the Almighty God. So that no time can you be overtaken. You are a soldier in the battlefield. You are a Christian marching in the battlefield. You are on a journey to the Most High God who sent you on a mission. Before you finish and start going back, you have to first of all accomplish His mission and purpose of creating you and sending you into the world. And it is a lifelong mission. It's not a mission of one day and finish, so I can now relax. No Christian finishes his mission until the day you breathe your last. So don't imagine that, I have accomplished my mission, so I can now relax. As long as God gives you a life, it means the mission is not completed. Praise the Lord. Once your mission on earth is done, you leave the world. Because that's the only reason you came into the world anyway. The only thing is to accomplish a mission. Look at Jesus as an example. He came on a mission. He was born to save. Hello? He was born to save. Even before being conceived, it was announced, His name shall be Savior. Jesus, Savior. Because He is coming to save. So, right from conception, mission has started. Day of His death, mission has started. Yes. Even on the day of His death, the mission has started. Because you can see what happened. Angels appeared and said, good news. Announcement. Shepherds went to worship. Mission has started. Why shepherds? Because He is to be the lamb that will be slain. So He has to be first of all worshipped by shepherds who look after lambs and sheep. Then, because He must be king, kings had to come and adore Him. Bringing the three symbols, gold, frankincense, and myrrh, to depict everything about Him. A to Z, priest, king, and what? And His death for us. So you see, from the beginning, so all of us are created and sent by God on a mission. And our mission is a lifelong thing. And as you can see in Jesus' case, that mission continued until on Calvary, He breathed His last with what? It is finished. Into your hands I commend my spirit. And go, sir. That's the end. Once the mission was accomplished, He left. You cannot be different. Jesus is the model for all our lives. Take your life as the life of Christ, whom you follow,
and realize that you were sent on a mission, and it started from the day you were born, even from the moment of your conception. And all those stories and history your mother can tell you about how you were conceived and what happened during her pregnancy and on the day you were born. The story has started of your life's mission. And it will not. Your mission cannot end until you breathe your last. Only then can you say, like Jesus on the cross, it is finished.
So, resting on your hands
at any point in time in life is stupidity as well as calamity. It is stupidity, it is calamity, it is catastrophe. Because to stand still and say I have finished is to have gone backward. That's Nightingale says, Florence Nightingale says. And to stand still when you have not arrived at your deathbed to say I'm done, and you stand still in the middle way and say I have finished my mission, I cannot relax.
Look, they are in the midst of faith. Watch and pray. You didn't hear that song? Christian, seek not yet repose. How can you say you have finished, you want to relax? When you are surrounded by enemy forces who want to stop you from getting back to your father's house to take your crown. They are surrounding you, and they are not surrounding you, looking at you. Some of you are stupid. You think the enemy, the devil, and the devil, you think they are surrounded and they are looking at you?
Are you cinema?
No.
You are not cinema that they are looking at.
You are their enemy. You are here to do what they refuse to do for God. So you are cited as an enemy. You are their arch enemy because you came and you said, I will do for God. I will serve. So you are targeted from the day you were born. To stop anywhere and say I have finished while your enemies are surrounding you, you must be imagining that they surround you to be looking at you. Listen to the soldier story I told earlier on. Do you remember? I said that as those other ones are fighting and throwing machine guns and shooting and bombs in the air, the other party are also shooting their own machine guns.
You stop fighting, you are dead. Straight. to keep guiding them and making them go into what? Look at where they hide while you pass. You must pass. For me, I must pass. I must pass. I'm on my way to heaven. And I must pass. And it's my business to keep my enemies far away. Using every strategy and battle weapon that God can teach me and give me. Using what I call all the powers of the mysteries of the Christian faith. Using all the powers of the logo that I am. And not so much using all the powers of the logo that you are. Of the battle warrior. Every Christian is a warrior. Every child of God is a warrior. And you fight to win. You fight to win. And you cannot say you have won until you have entered the gates of heaven victoriously. And the trumpet will sound. And the Father will dance. And he will bring out the crown he has kept for you. And he will put it on you. And then he will give you the robe of royalty. And then he will say, come my child. Welcome into the kingdom prepared for you. Come and sit here and dine with me, good and faithful servant. Only then you can heave a sigh of relief and say, Dios gracias, I've made it, I've arrived. No more fighting, no more weapons, no more battles. Glory, 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 hallelujah. And hallelujah, forever and forever and forever. Yes, only then you can relax when you get to heaven. But in this journey, you don't try it. Don't try it. Don't try it. The day you do so, you predispose yourself to everlasting death. Two reasons why you predispose yourself to everlasting death. One is that you have not completed your mission. You stopped prematurely because you haven't died and you stopped. Two, because in stopping, you allowed your enemies to descend on you and take you over. Which is, in other words, you allowed yourself to be defeated. And not defeated soon. Enter heaven. And you are there to heaven for two reasons. You didn't finish your work. You stopped. Telling yourself you are finished. And the mission unaccomplished, anybody who does not accomplish their life mission cannot enter the glory of God. Then you let yourself be defeated. And you become defeated and take it over. Because when you know in the battlefield, when the enemy defeats you, they take your ransom. So you're ready in the court of the devil. No place for you in heaven. So you are dead. Dead, double dead. Physically dead, spiritually dead, eternally dead. In fact, it is triple death. That is the reason you need a retreat. To know, am I winning? Am I making it? Have I stopped halfway? Have I stopped halfway thinking I have finished? Have I become moribund? A moribund Christian? Have I become a defeated Christian? Just alive, already defeated, already in the devil's court. Maybe they're taking your ransom already. They've already held your ransom in the devil's court, holding you. Is this ransom or prison? Already imprisoned you? They've already abducted you. Has the enemy already abducted you? You know, abduction is raining nowadays. So I can use the language. Are you already kidnapped by the devil? Already in their zone, abducted. And maybe wanting to use another Christian to ransom you. That's what they do. When they abduct one Christian, they will now use you and say, go and bring another. Bring another one, I will release you. And it's a lie. They will now use you as an agent to pull down somebody else. That's what I mean by using you as ransom. They tell you, go and get another Christian as ransom. If you can get another person to join you here in the evil that you are doing, you will be free. It's a lie. When you bring the other one, they will trap two of you together. Because they never tell you the truth. And that's what happens. When a Christian has fallen into the hands of the evil one, of Satan and his agents, the next thing you find is that Christian becomes the pull me down of others. Pull me down in quotes. That is to say, they begin, you now become an agent to pull down your friends, your family, and those around you. And it's the devil sending you. That's what I mean. Once they abduct you, they begin to even use you to get more people. Like the abductors of today, once they catch you, they use you to get the money from your family. At the expense of all around you. May we never ever become abducted by the devil. May we never ever predispose ourselves to becoming abducted or kidnapped by Satan and his agents. I'm talking about spiritually now. Spiritual kidnap. Yes. A lot of Christians have been kidnapped spiritually. They are already in the devil's territory, already being used as agents of darkness, but they don't know. A lot of them got there into all those things that they are doing that are contrary to God because they had no goal, no objective, did not have a mission, or if they had a mission, they lost the sense of mission, or they started well and they stopped halfway and relaxed, or they never made a retreat back to square one topic. They never made a retreat to access and evaluate themselves, to cross-check, using certain yardstick to know where am I, what happened to me. No retreat is the cause of all those things I've been talking about. All the defeat and the story is all coming from what? No retreat. A Christian that does not stop, that does not retreat to check himself, becomes a prey to the evil one. You let yourself be defeated, you let yourself be abducted, you let yourself be taken over, you let yourself become an agent, you let yourself be kidnapped in spirit, you let yourself, in fact, there's no end. You let yourself now become an agent to pull other people down. You allow yourself to be an instrument of destruction. Simply, you were not making a retreat. I'm talking about retreat. Value or retreat. It is uncountable. I can spend the whole day talking about it till tomorrow. We can talk about it till tomorrow. No end. My heart is full, my mouth is full of what I want to say about retreat. And it is pouring. And I don't see it being exhausted today. So, how often, therefore, should we make a retreat? Having said so much, how often should you make a retreat, oh Christian, oh child of God? What did you say there in this? Three times a year, she said. What? You should do it three times. Okay, she said Advent long retreat and what? And Lenten retreat. Well, I don't want us to waste time, the day is far gone. As far as I'm concerned, you make a retreat every day. Hello? You should make a retreat every day. Because If you are surrounded by the fail, you are vigilant and cross-checking every day. And if we have agreed that retreat is a time for, you have to be vigilant, you have to be observant, you have to be, what are the things I said? You know, it was falling from my mouth. I can't even remember what I said, but I think I said something. All those things I said, it's not important to do 3 times a year. No, 3 times a year? And your enemy is waiting for you to stop at 3 times a year. When they are reinforcing every day. You know, what you Christians don't understand is this. The enemy you are dealing with does not rest. The Bible taught us that. They run around you so many times per minute to make sure you are destroyed. The devil is following around you like a roaring lion. Second, minute by minute. As you are about to leave your house and come for prayer, God is there. Trying to say, don't go. You have reason not to go. Your shop, your child, or this, or that, don't go. As you step out and say, I must go, somebody knocks at your door. You send somebody to knock at your door. A visitor arise to delay you. You think that ordinary eye? That's them fighting. Enemies of your faith. Because he knows that if you come here, he will hear all these things I'm saying. And your life will be better. So, first of all, don't go, your shop, your this, your that, or tell you, oh, your leg is failing, you can't go today. You know you are not feeling strong, you can't go, why not rest? As you say, I must go, you wear your dress. As soon as you want to lock the door, somebody knocks at the door. Asking you one thing or the other, or a visitor from the village. Or if you're a trader, somebody will come and buy something that will make you want to say, let me hold on. Or it will become Thursday that is your market day. When the shop is fuller than before. Because Thursday is prayer day. So your shop will be full. So tempt you not to go for prayer. And when you now decide, sorry, I can't answer you. I must go now for prayer. As you get to the road, that may be the day that all your cadets are on strike. Or there's the fuel shortage. Or one thing or the other, so that you will not get there. Are you prepared for such kinds of attack? That's the enemy's strategy. They're not resting over you. Like I said, you've been sighted, and they are determined to make sure that crown. You won't wear it though. They don't have crown. Why should you wear crown? That's all. They envy you. They're jealous of you being a child of God. They are jealous of the supreme plans that God has for his children. They are jealous of your happiness eternal, which they can never have anymore, because they've lost it the day they rebelled against God. So anything that will make you wear the crown is in opposition to your enemy, the devil, and his agents. But the things that will make you lose the crown, oh yes, they will encourage you to go and do it. In fact, they will help you to bring it, make it available to you. Like that sugar daddy, that will make you commit fornication and whatever every day. Oh, bring him to her. That money you are looking for, oh, show her the easy way to get it. So that you will not get to heaven. But the things that will make you get to heaven, like coming for prayer and Thursdays. Coming to hear the word of God, to make people have to adjust their life for good. They are in a position, and they will send every weapon. Some of us are talking about bullets and machine guns. Some of you folks are talking about physical bullets or physical machine guns. No! These are the bullets. These are the machine guns. The bullets to stop you, to kill you, and kill your soul. If you make sure you don't go for prayer, send somebody to her, that's one bullet. you woke up and they're killing you.
Not a trick, my enemy. And remember when you come for prayer, after prayer, the devil won't pay you again. Am I right? He's gone. You know, the next video, I don't know whether you want to go for video. Leg will come again. They come and say, this leg sent me last week. When I come for prayer, he said, come go. Now, when I come, want to come today again, the leg will pay me. Photo trick. Just like some of you know how to do photo trick and photoshopping, Satan too knows how to photo trick your leg and photo trick any part of your body. Because in the flesh. It's for you, Satan, to say, this is not true, this is not real. In Jesus' name, be gone, you this pain. I'm going for prayer. And you jump up and go. You find that the time you take 2 steps, the pain will go. Because you conquered it with the power of your word. The power on your lips. You have the power as a child of God on your lips to defeat the weapons of the enemy anytime, anywhere. You have it on your lips. You just say, in the name of Jesus, I am going for this prayer. And this, my leg, cannot stop me from going for that prayer. You have conquered. And you can say, this thing, be gone, because whatever day I come. Or if it is mass, say, I'm going to this mass. And you, this leg, you can't stop me from going to mass. You will find that by that power, because you see, what some of you don't understand is that in as much as I said, they sighted you, they are looking at you, they are attacking you. Listen to me, Christian, listen well. Who is stronger than the other? The devil and his agents are the Christian side of God. Who is stronger? Of course, the Christian child of God is stronger by far. No comparison. So when they say they're excited, they are looking at you, they're specific weapons. Yeah, you are stronger. Arise in the strength of God upholding you. Throw it back at them. Use every power given to you by God, including the power on your lips. There is power in your word. There is power on your lips. When they come at you, what did the Bible say? In the book of Deuteronomy chapter 28, what did my God say? Through Moses, he said what? The enemy may come at you from one direction, but they will run from you in several directions. You think they run from you in several directions for nothing? Because you are stronger. So the Bible did not say they will not come. So what I'm preaching is in keeping with the Bible. They will try to come. They will attack. They will sell weapons. But my Bible tells me, chapter 28 of Deuteronomy, that though they come in one direction at you, they will run from you in several directions. Come and stand in. But they will never run from you in several directions if you have the power of the Christian child of God. And what is the power of the Christian child of God? The power of obedience. Obedience to God. The power of living in God's will. In case somebody is wondering, what are the powers I have? When I said all the powers of the mysteries of the Christian faith. Power is power in obedience to God. When you are living in the will of God and in obedience to God, you have the power of the child of God that will make them run away from you in several directions. You also have the power of the Eucharist. You have the power of the mysteries of the Most Holy Rosary of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Which is a cane, a serious cane for the devil, as was shown to me years back, 1993. You also have the power of the Mother of Christ behind you as your mother, who
who is the queen of the battlefield. That's the name I give her. I call her queen of the battlefield. There's no battle I go to. The mother is not in the battlefield. So you have the power of the queen of the battlefield, who is the mother of Christ, our Redeemer, who goes with us on every battle against the devil. And when she goes to battle against the devil with her children, we are sure winners. Why? Because she is the one of whom it is written and said that she crushed the head of the serpent. Praise the Lord. She it is that crushed. She it was who crushed the head of the serpent from the very beginning. Praise the Lord. So you have her. Then you have the power of faith in the Redeemer.
Machine gun, hoping to kill your soul.
are rendering you inactive in God so that he can kidnap you to his territory. But you have the victory. And I said, enjoy the victory. Enjoy the powers of the mysteries of the Christian faith. Use it. It's on your lips. It is in your heart. This good news I'm proclaiming, that Christ has given us the victory. It's on your lips. Believe it in your heart. Then speak it. Speak the words of victory. Speak the words of conquest. Then they go and recoup and they come with their machine gun. No problem. You have something greater than machine gun of the devil. Whatever weapons they release, you the Christian and I, we the Christians, we have more than they have on our side. We have more weapons on our side. We have more power on our side. The devil can never be too strong for a Christian. Never was it known that anyone who believes in God and is a true child, submissive to God in obedience and living in God's will, never was it known that a child of God is defeated by the devil. It's a lie. Go and check your records again. It's unheard of. For instance, if you are coming to prayer and they come and attack by sending an agent to stop you, if you are vigilant, that's why the Lord said be vigilant. And you quickly, and I said be vigilant, I gave you three things. Be vigilant, the eighth again, intelligence, and wise. If you have those three qualities I gave you today, vigilant, intelligence, wise, they are dressing up for prayer and knock, knock, knock on the door, somebody comes. Mama and God, I want to buy a kerosene. Kerosene that will take you 15 minutes to sell, look for change. Can you not see that this is a weapon being fashioned against you? Not a weapon. But if you are not vigilant, you will not call it weapon. You will call it blessing. Hello? Do you understand what I mean? If you are not vigilant, intelligent, and wise, you will say what? You will call demons from the devil. When you are looking for the better player, it's about a money mass. That is the bullet. It is like the bullet. That machine gun to stop you from receiving communion or to be late and miss your party. But if you are not intelligent and wise and vigilant, you will call the devil's weapon a war. You will call it a blessing. Meet me for house. You don't know what you call it. You see, I said, in fact, I don't the talk, say, where I go get money for my child school fees. Now, the woman just comes, say, he won't buy one jerrycan of kerosene. Hey, 10,000. Hey, God bless you, know. Thank you for blessing. You see what I mean by calling the devil's weapon, Because you are not intelligent. Because you are not vigilant. You are not spiritually vigilant. So see that money that the devil is sending somebody to come and give you, when she comes to worship God, it's danger to your soul. That's all money. That's a bullet. That's a machine gun. So knock it down. And say you give it. And you stay there and begin to sell one jerrycan of kerosene for 5,000 naira. And you call the devil's strategy a blessing from God. You cannot see with God's wisdom that God cannot contradict himself. If the intelligence are wise in spirit, you will know that God cannot contradict himself. God cannot be sending somebody to buy kerosene 5,000 when you should be worshiping him in the church. The Holy Spirit does not contradict itself. You will be able to stand up against that evil one and do as St. Paul said. Stand up to him, strong in faith. Stand up, strong in faith. And give him the defeat by saying, I'm sorry, I am running to church. Madam, come back later. I don't want to be late to Mass. many of you can do that? How many? You see? Nobody. You will see. You see, that is the hair we are talking about. You cannot say, sorry, madam, I cannot. I am ready to match right now. And if you are able to use the rest and say, use the phone, get your match. You rebuke him and say, you see, to say, God forbid, this kerosene, I'm not selling you because you are going to make me late for match. The penny of Christ I must receive is more important than this 5,000. And you now open your mouth and say to the person, I'm sorry, I cannot wait. I have to be in church right now. And you move on. What does he mean by they shoot at you? You do what? You shoot back. They send machine gun. You fire them back with your own double machine, gun. You understand now? In case of a few things, I'm saying you should go and buy machine gun. This is a spiritual warfare. They come at you with temptations. They make you die, spiritual death, as a form. You give back. If you are what? Vigilant, intelligent, and wise. And then you win that one. Then on the road, you stand there, no Akada. No this, no that. And the devil says to you, better go back. You cannot make it. And you don't know what to do. Another attack. That one is fossil bomb they are sending. Maybe helicopter roaming around your head saying, go back! Helicopter roaming with bomb. They fried machine gun you conquered at home. On the road, they send helicopter. I'm referring back to my initial parable about the war field. You know? Going around your head telling you, go back! Go back! Go back! Oh, can't you see you've been standing here now? You can't make it. You can't make it. See now. No vehicle. No petrol. Hovering around your head. That's a fossil bomb. That's a bomb they want to drop. That should be the last straw to shatter your motive and your good intention. It's up to you. Forgive them. Send a supernatural dinner helicopter to hover over their own and bam! Make it crash land on their head. By saying, be not angry, and your turn is Jesus. Be the power, and your turn is Jesus. Be not angry, but the Lord will tell you. God and it is you. It's a little bit. It's not the time to sing that song. You will just say, when they are saying, go back, that's when you will say, Okada, Mokaya, Balebo, PAD, I come, I must attend it. Okada, Balebo, PAD, I come. Use your head. Call your head to Futron. And start checking. Once you do that, you have hitched up their own helicopter. And the signal they are sending to kill you, so not to make you get away your way. You have given it a technical knockout. It will disappear. And the minute you check and tell the Lord, for your sake, I will walk. You will discover that the Lord you are faithful to, by the time you walk from here to there, a car or somebody you don't know will just come and say, can I help you? Has it happened to you before? Oh. A car you don't know will stop. Or maybe somebody you know will communicate yourself. But somebody will come and say, ah. Oh dear, where did they go? Oh, your answer. You will not be in air conditioned car. And don't get for Okada. You will not arrive the compound with her in air conditioned jeep. Praise the Lord. But if you had allowed them with their hovering idea over your head, go back, you see now? You see now? You see you want to go for prayer for mass. See now, God very good. Go back. You can't make it. If you give it, you have allowed their bomb to drop on you. That's what I mean by them fossil bomb. So do you use all kinds of
the weapons are in the daily events of your life. And you too must conquer the devil in the daily events of your life. And that is why I am saying that retreat cannot be 3 times a year. Okay? Retreating, examining and checking and cross-checking, am I winning? Can therefore not be 3 times a year. When you are surrounded by the enemy in spirit and in things and places around you, and they are fighting you moment by moment, second by second in spirit, you cannot be retreating 3 times a year. You have to retreat every day. You must make a daily retreat. You must make a daily retreat. People of God, you must make a daily retreat. Daily retreat, early morning, a quiet place to check where you are coming from. Or in the evening, take a walk on your own. Go to a quiet place. If you have a chapel or somewhere, sit down, look back on the day, and see how victorious you have been. And check who is winning. Am I winning? Or the enemy, the devil, and his agents are winning? Check every day, either early morning or in the evening. Go and check. Who fought me today? Was I attacked? Did I conquer? What were the various attacks I had? When I say attack, not to my own kind of attack, everything attack. Not the one that they live with for you say attack. Any doctor backs attack. No, that's not what I mean. This type of thing I'm telling you is what I mean. What were the ways that they tried to attack me spiritually, to lose faith, or not worship God, or go to serve God? Because those are the things that are giving the crown in heaven. Those are the things they're attacking. They don't have to send a leaf for a bird. Sometimes they do, but that's once in a while that happens. But you are faced with the enemy's weapons and attacks almost every minute of the day. You have to keep being vigilant and willing and checking. Any morning or evening, what were the various ways that they sent their bullets? Did I conquer them? Did I defeat them by the word of my testimony? Did I defeat them by my good works? Did I defeat them by my perseverance? Did I defeat the enemy by word of command? Did I defeat the enemy by my charity, my love for others? Did I rise up to a expectation of my Lord Jesus in every situation? Did I give in to the temptation and the weapons? Were they the enemies? Were they able to pull me down or stop me from doing what I have to do for God? If they did, then you failed. And you have to recoup on a daily basis. You have to recoup. You have to re-strategize and say, this thing that happened to me today, I will not let it happen tomorrow. You see what I mean? So you need a daily retreat. They don't now say, oh my goodness, it's now beginning to see, that thing that happened just when I was about to leave the house was really the enemy's strategy. And I gave in, I didn't go again. I didn't go to that mass again, I didn't go to that prayer or whatever again that God wanted me to go. And then you now say to yourself, all right, okay, they conquered today, tomorrow, I will deal with them. You make yourself a resolution. Because every retreat calls for resolution. When you make a retreat, you do not end up with a resolution for a better planning and strategy. You don't resolve to get back to the battlefield and be a winner. Then your retreat is useless. So that's another point. So after retreating, strategizing, all the things I said earlier on, then there must come what? Resolution to win. Resolution to be victorious. Resolution to have the victory and never be defeated. Resolution to persevere to the very end. There has to be
a landmark by which you can count victory, and follow that landmark to the end until you wear the crown. People of God, I can continue, but I think we should stop here, chew what we have heard, digest it, put it into action on a daily basis, start with a daily retreat, then you can do weekly retreat, then you can now do monthly reconnection or retreat. Before you start talking about Advent retreat, and Lenten retreat, and long retreat in August. Can come. But this is for my personal life and your individual personal life. This has to be a daily, a weekly, a monthly, then 3 monthly or quarterly, or the one you say 3 times a year. Okay. But if you're sitting down there working for those 3 retreats in a year, oh my goodness, you're already dead. I say you are what? You are dead. You don't die finish before you go, no. Before you don't say you die, you don't die finish. You're already in the grave. Please, mind yourselves. Christians, arise. Christians, wake up. Christians, slumber not, nor sleep. Because the one who keeps you neither slumbers nor sleeps. Christians, seek not yet repose. Christians, employ every power of the mysteries of the Christian faith. Christians, remember, you are already a winner. If only you will believe you are a winner, you have already conquered the evil one. Because Jesus said so. Amen. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Remember, the secret is what? What's the secret? The secret is retreat. Constantly retreating. You want me to say more? I wanted to stop. Look at the Bible. Jesus was always on retreat. Daily retreat. Two of us. Are you not aware that every morning he left everybody and went where? Went somewhere to the mountain, to a quiet place, to be. To be what? To be alone. Not retreat. Hello? That's what? Retreat. Okay. Maybe I should have told you. But retreat simply means what? Withdrawing, isn't it? Moving away. Move away. Withdraw. I said so. But did I say withdraw from what? You have to withdraw. 3 levels or 4 levels of withdrawal is my suggestion. The next one to say I'm retreating. Spiritual withdrawal. Physical withdrawal. Emotional withdrawal. And even psychically, you need to withdraw. Physically, move away from people. Anytime you move away from people to be alone for the sake of God, and you have to think again, that's a retreat. Be it for 1 hour, you're retreating. Spiritually, withdraw from the devil. Withdraw from sin. Move away from sin. Run away from sin. Move away from sin. Move away from the bad things you're doing. You are retreating from the evil one. Emotional withdrawal. Move away from anger. Move away from lust. Withdraw from temper. Temper tantrum. Withdraw from your envy.
ever since. Because from all those useless sentiments and emotions that lure you to sin, withdraw, take away your mind, your emotions from them. Withdraw from all the errors in your life. You are retreating. Retreat for me. I told you, look, if I start talking, you shall not finish. So you need to withdraw. So what? His son said, remember that Jesus had a daily retreat. Then he told me that, come on, maybe don't even understand. But it's not until you go and book a retreat. And book a retreat house. No one is general retreat, communal retreat. Put you on a personal basis. You retreat every day to a quiet place, to be alone with God. Not retreat. On a weekly basis. For me now, every Thursday is like a retreat. Because I withdraw and I'm alone with my God until I come out to join you. Apart from the daily. Jesus did it daily. You can do daily. Withdraw. Go to the Father. Look back. I'm sure when Jesus went to the mountain, he was able to look back at what he did the day before, what he did and to replan and re-strategize, what he will do that day. And then he will come down and action begins. We say he went to the mountain to pray. Yes, retreat is prayer. Retreat is a form of prayer. So we say he went to the mountain to pray. I am saying he went to the mountain on retreat to pray, to commune with the Father, re-strategize, check, cross-check, work out what he will do today, how to do it, and to do it better for the Father. That's it! Oh, Selamari, stop talking. It's enough. And I'm gonna stop talking. Or rather, shall I say, my Lord Jesus, do you have more to say? I'm ready to keep talking, my Lord, until you tell me to stop. So I cannot say, Selamari, stop talking. I'd rather say, my Lord, are we ready to stop or shall I continue anymore? Don't let me forget anything you want to say that I have not said. And I'm not prepared to shut up until you, my Lord, say, it's okay, you can keep quiet. So long as your will is done and they have heard everything you want them to hear, speak. Your servant is listening. What does it matter if we decide to talk to them till tomorrow? But for now, it is enough. We have fed them, that it may not be too much. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And let all I have said bear its truth in your life, and in my life, and for eternity, for the glory of God the Father. Amen. Through Christ our Lord. Our Mother Mary, intercede for us. Amen. As I commend you all to the Immaculate Heart of Mary, the home that I know, the home of comfort, a sure refuge, is the Immaculate Heart of Mary. I put everybody there. In Jesus' name. And through her, to her Son, who is one with the Holy Trinity, so our heaven is sure. In Jesus' name. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.